Good afternoon. Welcome. Today is the fourth and the last day of the European Conference on Architecture and the Media. These days coincide also with, for us, with a bit the coming back to the normality after the confinement at home. And I hope that in a way we will back to the working routine enriched by different experience and contribution from colleagues and from other professionals involved into architecture and its dissemination into the media that we were listening and sharing experience during these days. The day of today is dedicated to a cross-cutting topic in the dissemination of architecture, the architectural image. This morning, together with the lawyer Rick Henrique and the prestigious front row of architects, photographers and institutions, we have touched the most relevant aspect of copyright in the architectural image. And now, with great pleasure, we have with us the worldwide renowned photographer Ivan Ban, who will be in conversation with Eva Porebska, architect, editor-in-chief of the Architectura Murator magazine. Eva was also curator with me on the first edition of Architecture and the Media, as she was the person who pointed out to have the opportunity and the importance to have an event like this. This is, of course, also a day of thanks. I'm really grateful to the Fundación Miss van der Rohe, to Anna Ramos, Ivan Blasi, to Valentina Pulian for the art direction, Anna and Tony. Thank you to Creative Europe to support this event. And thank you to my wonderful team, Marta, Erika, Gemma, and Antonio. A very, very great thank to Jordi Taglieda from Linca, who permit us to do something new for us, an entire conference online. And to the media partner, World Architects, Art Daily, The Zine, Metalocus, Detail, Art Tribune, Diseño Interior, On Diseño, Pipan, and Diario Design. And to all the speakers, I want to thank all the speakers that enthusiastically accepted to be part of Architecture in the Media 2020. Oliver Wainwright, Ivan Ban, Stefan Genciulescu, Eva Porebska, Marco Brizzi, Adam Goss and Red Mike, Nuria Molinel, José Luis Blasquez, Ruta Laitanaite, Inigo Picabea, and Andrew Tuck. So, thank you again. Now we will see the presentation of Ivan Ban, and at the end, Eva Porebska will launch the conversation with him, and you are all invited to post your question to the speakers in the chat of the YouTube channel of Miss van der Rohe Foundation. Thank you.
Yes, so my name is Ivan Ban. I've been photographing basically since I was a kid and I got my first camera. I went to art school, studied there photography, and for a couple of years after art school, did much more documentary photography. And it was a little bit by accident that I fell into the whole architecture field through my fellow Dutchman, Rem Koolhaas, and he got me completely hooked up in the architecture field, and I got completely fascinated with that field. And for me, it was really a way to combine my interest in places and people, how people live in all kinds of different places around the world, and what influence architects make in that field. That was for me kind of my entrance into the architecture field. And I still consider myself not really an architectural photographer. It's like, of course, my commissioned work is these days mainly from architects or their clients, or has to do a lot around all the issues around the built environment. But for me, the field is much broader, that trying to document how people live in very different circumstances all around the world. Yeah, they're always come via different ways. Of course, there's a lot of long-term collaborations I have with many architects, where I document all their projects for others. There's like commissions coming in and out, but what I enjoy a lot is also collaborations, for instance, with universities or institutions, more focusing on a specific subject, on a specific city, on a specific living condition, and really explore it in that way. And out of that come a lot of books or exhibitions or different kind of longer term projects than just a commission for a new building, also offers me, of course, a chance to travel a lot. But those longer term collaborations are really interesting always. And then besides that, you come all the time in very different places where you sometimes encounter really unusual circumstances, subjects, places, people, and so out of which other projects are born, which are kind of self-initiated. Yes, I think there's different projects which come to mind, but probably the project which reached the widest audience also outside the architecture field is that image I took of the big storm Sandy when it hit New York 7 years ago. I happened to be in the city because of another commission, which was postponed, of course, because of the big storm, and there was no electricity and so on. So, and as a big part of my sort of visual language of projects I photograph are these aerial pictures over places, over cities, over buildings, and so. So I thought like the only way to capture this moment with a city without electricity, and especially at night in the complete darkness, is this aerial shot over the city. So I happened to find a pilot whom I knew outside the city who could fly me back into the city, and I took that image of New York over the in the complete darkness, where you really saw the divide of the city in the dark and the part of the city which still had electricity, and it became the cover of New York magazine and sort of became a kind of iconic image of that unique moment and the vulnerability of a big city in this kind of time. So that's kind of went all over the world. But besides that, probably the project I did together with Urban Think Tank on the Torre David in Caracas, for which we got the Golden Lion in Venice. These kind of projects, they, I think, touch a wide audience. Like, they're very unusual living conditions for a lot of people, but I find them very interesting because, like, yeah, people find such different ways to live all around the world. And for these people, it was a total normal way of, yeah, finding a home and creating a home out of almost nothing. And these kind of challenges, how people create kind of places for themselves, I find totally fascinating and important to share also with a wide audience and show to a very different audience who's not familiar with these kind of places. Now, a project where I worked on a lot over the last year and a half, 2 years, together with Tatiana Bilbao, a Mexican architect. She initiated this project, a collaboration with 11 universities around the US and Mexico, who each university and each professor with its students was doing research on one specific aspect, specific location, either in the US where you saw the Mexican influence in America or the American influence in Mexico, and all the issues around the border. And that project started, just after Trump got elected, and we thought like it would be really important to show, like, yeah, what are these differences and commonalities between these two countries, and yeah, what the impact of the border has between these two parts of the Americas. Totally fascinating subject, I thought, and these all the projects, they were with architecture universities and students who thought about how these places could be improved or could work in a way. But my photography was really looking, how can you visualize this, the Mexican influence in America in these places and vice versa, and all these issues around the border. Really fascinating subject, and totally different places all around the Americas which we visited. And it's we're still working on the book, and there's an exhibition around it, and like it's gaining some traction and some recognition. But I feel also like with the issues we're facing right now with COVID and like all the mass migration, which took a complete turn the other way around, like it feels we're living at the moment in a very different world where these issues are very differently, or maybe not recognized so much. So I'm not sure in what kind of way this will unfold, this project. Yeah, it's strange. In the last, 15, 18 years that I've been working with architects, I felt there is quite a shift. In one way, design and architecture got a lot of recognition, but I feel also like the big newspapers like cut back a lot on architecture, like the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal. And it's difficult sometimes to reach a very wide audience outside the architecture bubble and architecture field with architecture magazines. And of course, like at the same moment, it's hard to really judge, but because at the same moment we live in a time, I think, that there are more magazines and more architecture magazines than ever, and there's also so many, of course, online ways to promote architecture, and there's, I think, both ways, but sometimes it feels very much that we're in a very small architecture bubble living, especially when the issues at the moment are becoming so big and so touching every point of life. So.
Hello, good evening again. It seems that we have some technical problem that probably is normal the last day when you think everything is under control. So I will try to be the substitute of Eva in putting the question to Ivan. That is an honor for me. So these questions came from Eva. So Ivan is the first question that Eva would like to pose to you is about your the meeting you had with Kulas. I mean, she said you have repeatedly said in interviews that the fact that you take photos of architecture is due to your meeting with Rem Kulas and collaboration in his exhibition 15 years ago. Before that, you have been involved in documentary and press photography. And I found it's very interesting, since, as we know, Kulas has been a journalist before he became an architect. So you're so close to documentary photography. And the question is, what was in your meeting with Kulas that triggered your permanent interest in architecture? Or maybe I should ask, what did you find of such interest in architecture that it took over your life?
Yeah, that's what it was never planned so much to be a photographer in the whole architecture field. Like what you said, also like after art school, I did for many years much more documentary work and all kinds of things. And it was in 2004 that a good friend of mine was working with Rem on an exhibition, and I had a small proposal for that exhibition to visualize that. I put it on paper and he showed it to Rem, and then Rem asked me to come to the office to show my work and what I had in mind. And it was a very interesting moment in time there for the office. It was 2004, 2005. The office had just finished four major projects: the Seattle Public Library, the Casa de Musica in Porto, the IIT in Chicago, and Berlin, the embassy. And Rem was working on a couple of publications around those. And he just said, he saw something in my way of photographing places, and so and thought he just sent me to these places and said figure it out, and I had no idea really what I was doing in terms of architecture, but I found it fascinating, of course, like the locations where these buildings were built, the cities, and in a way we're all living, of course, with architecture everywhere around us, and it's every it's been a background in my photographs and the way I've been documenting places and so on. So it was also like for me not really a different way of photographing or looking at places, and it was a kind of very natural transition for me, and totally fascinating, like a totally new world for me which opened up. And there was so much happening also there in the office. It was, of course, the start of the CCTV tower in Beijing, the construction there of that. And so I proposed at the same time also to Rem to start documenting that over the next couple of years during construction. I had the idea, the feeling that it could be an interesting document at some point to see like how something like that big and massive in such a city, and then with the tens of thousands of migrant workers who come there, who live on site, and all these sort of, at the same time, the city which is being demolished, these new things which were happening, I thought it could be interesting. So I started working on that, and I very quickly sort of from one came the other, and I was totally surrounded by architects, but that was never really planned in that way.
It's curious because in the last edition we used a sentence by Colas saying that architecture has a serious problem with communication. So did you ever spoke with Colas about this aspect? He told you something about this?
No, I think we never discussed that so much in detail, but I think maybe what interested him also that for me, like architecture was never like the focus or the subject so much. Like it's also, you try to tell a story on a place and what people do there, how they experience a place, also how they experience a city, what the building does in the city. And so you try to sort of ask yourself questions. Why is it here and not somewhere else? And what is the effect of it in a place? And I guess that interested him as well.
Thank you. And a question about the approach with the commission. So when you approach for a commission, do you first create a concept, a kind of a scenario, or you just let go with the moment and place? Before you go there to the place, do you analyze project, discuss it with the architects? Do you try to take his vision into the account or not? Or
no, like it's a very intuitive approach usually. Like I try to go to places without too much prior knowledge about it. And I feel also like architects, they work for so long on a building, and you get a little bit of problem like what you have when you live in a place, like you start to overlook sort of the everyday things. And it's always very refreshing to enter a place kind of blank without too much prior knowledge, and you're like totally open to kind of everything what is happening there, and you really engage with a location and a site and the people and so on, and you start to see also the sort of the other things which you might not pick up immediately on when you're there all the time or you know the whole thing. So and yeah, then you sort of start working on it and things kind of develop usually quite naturally, and both for sort of my commissions work with architects as well as my own projects, they kind of develop in that similar way.
Oh, okay. And this question starts from a sentence that Eva said, "I heard that on many photographs, the buildings you photographed look better than they really were. This is what it's about. In other words, the determination and purposefulness is the essence of each photo we take." These words, published in Architectura Murator, the magazine of Eva Poreska, in 2009, were uttered by Julius Schulman, one of the most renowned photographers of architecture, who photographed work of Oscar Niemeyer, Mies van der Rohe, Frank Lloyd Wright, and others. A general belief is that it is to Schulman that we owe the characteristic way of showing modernist building as idealized icons through strong colors. And what is your vision of photos of architecture? Do you try to make architecture look better or just the opposite?
Yeah, I think that was also like very much a problem of that time of Julius Schulman and the photography, or not so much a problem, but like a way of looking at that time at architecture. Like it was like photography was so focused just on the building and like kind of removed from any context. You try to show, like what I try to do is also step away from the architecture and not show sort of that completely cut out detail removed from the context. And you try to show it more kind of in everyday life, the larger context and so. And I think with that you remove also a little bit that the problem that things like what Schulman often did was like photographed from a very low, so space looks much bigger than it actually is, or like removed from the context, and that kind of might make things look much grander and bigger than they are in person. And I think like I don't know, like you try to be sort of objective in your photography. Like I don't edit things out or make it like really look better than it usually is. Like you try also to work with all the sort of the messiness and the everyday life around it to give it sort of a meaning and a place and a context. And you use all these elements also like to sort of compose your image and so. And the only sort of editing I really do is a little bit of color correction, the things you did before in the dark room in that way.
Yeah, actually the next question is related with this, because she said in his camera Lucida, Reflection on Photography, Roland Barthes, French critic, writer, and above all semiotician, said that photography is like Cassandra, but looking back to the past, it never lies. So the question is connected with the other one. Eva want to ask you, in your photos, is it truth that matters? And do you correct the image, retouch, or remove unwanted elements? That I understood them not. And in your opinion, is an architect photographer allowed to do it?
Yeah, that's of course a little bit the problem also with architecture photography. Like a lot of it becomes almost like product photography or kind of advertising photography for a place where like a client asks you to remove all kind of things. I always resist that urge, and I usually try to incorporate these like these maybe unwanted elements, so to say, like it incorporate them also in a way in the overall look of the picture, that like they start to give tell another story of the place, and that it's maybe not as kind of plastic fantastic maybe as a client has it in mind, but it tells also like another interesting story of kind of everyday life, and give it a meaning of why it's in that place and not somewhere else. And so I try to resist that, and I think also for photographs to be published in the other media outside the architecture field, like you need to show pictures like without editing things out, like you can't really, as a journalist, there's no way that you can get away with like an edited picture which is photoshopped, takes out lamppost or the trash or all of this sort of thing. So no, for me that's not something I do.
And about one of your patients, these aerial photographs. Well executed and selected photographs may make a building noticed and remembered by the public. Such are emblematic photographs of a finalist of the Miss Van der Rohe competition, the house for the elderly in Portugal, but by Aire Mateus Arquitectos, taken by Portuguese photographers Fernando Guerra and Sergio Guerra. Architectural minimalism has been shown in a very convincing way. Watching such photographs, could one suppose that in reality the house neighbors upon traditional and very low-key architecture? I know that you, in turn, like to take aerial photos. In such a photo, the architectural context and the real surroundings are clearly displayed. However, an ordinary man never sees architecture in bird's eye view. So, in your opinion, what is the use of such photographs?
Yeah, like for me, it was always something. I was always interested in that aerial perspective also before working with architects. Like, I find it a fascinating way to look at cities and at places, and it gives you such an incredible understanding of a place. And it was for me always a little strange when I started working in this whole architecture field and looking at architectural photographs before, like that aerial photo perspective was usually not included, whereas like in the project when it's developed and models are made, site models are made, like that's the primary way architects kind of start, or like one of the ways architects start to design and incorporate it in a context. So I thought that for me that was a very natural way to include that perspective also there. But the same like with people, like which were so for so long completely absent in architectural photography, and the sort of timelessness, and like I try really to give it a place and a time, and give it a place through that those aerial photographs, that you can understand the context where it is that a building is not removed from its context, but if you tell a story like how a city grew around it, or how a building fits in that context, or sometimes the total juxtaposition of it in the context and the strangeness in it in the context. And I think these things you can really read from that aerial perspective. So it's just another layer of describing a place. And photography is also a way, like it doesn't have to always show exactly the same perspective or to show what everyone else sees. Like it's also, you try to shed a kind of different life on light on a place, and try to open people's eyes to like a different perspective or a way to look at the place, and it can be in all kind of different ways.
Because in other interviews you also said you quite love technology. So what was your development in the using of the technology and the evolution of digital photograph and use of drones and use aerial views?
I like technology, but it's also at the same time, you try, of course, to work with sort of the best tools which are available at the time. But at the same time, like, you try to forget it immediately and really use it as a tool to capture, like, to find the best way to describe a place. And definitely, like, the development in that sense of digital photography, like, I was also an early adopter in that way, like, it allowed also a different kind of photography, especially with architecture, I think, where so much of the architectural photography used to be like large 4x5 technical cameras and so, where you need your assistance with, you needed a big tripod, you need to set up a shot, sometimes needed extra lighting and all these kind of things. And with the whole move to digital photography, like, that allowed also the same qualities in the photographs, but like, I try to use, for instance, a tripod as little as possible, and it's mostly handheld, so you're much closer to a subject, you can react much quicker to, like, sort of, yeah, moments which are happening in front of you, which you cannot really predict, or so that was a first move. And of course, nowadays, like, you have the things like with drones to get that aerial perspective quicker, but like, I've been photographing these aerial perspectives for a long time, and then usually with helicopters or little airplanes, and it's just like, it's another tool basically in your toolbox as a photographer to tell a story on a place.
And of course, we know you travel a lot, you travel all the time, you see many places, you meet many people. But of course, most of your photographs or your pictures are of building or for architecture. How do you choose commissions, destination? What is it that make you decide whatever you are going photographing a building or not?
Yeah, I think for me, what's the most important is like how, what kind of story and what can I tell around the building and a place. And like, it doesn't have to be always architecture for me for commission, or like architecture which I really like it can be also something very strange, which absolutely, like, yeah, where you can tell a whole different story on the context or the place. But I think that the story around it is for me one of the most urgent questions I try to ask myself when I go to a place or when I accept a commission. It is not just a building which can be anywhere, but which is very rooted in a specific place, and what you can tell there. And I think then it's also important to look at it in a fresh and a new way in that sense. And maybe that's also why I hardly photograph actually in the Netherlands, which is officially still my base, but like, in a way, it's a place which I know so well, and you start to overlook also things, although now I'm kind of forced to be here, so you start to look also maybe in a different way again at that sort of everyday life.
You will rediscover Netherlands, yeah, in a way, thanks to the lockdown. And what subjects are most interesting to you personally? Or is there a subject or a place you would like to photograph? Your professional challenge or your professional dream? What it would be if you have to, you know, to dream a place?
Like, a big collection for me over the last decennia has become also like the vernacular ways people use, traditional ways people used to build. And I find there is such an incredible variety in the ways people found ways to build places for themselves, which were very, based on local traditions, local materials. Of course, there was no international shipping of any kind of materials, so you really had to work with whatever came there right out of the ground, or and so on. So there was such an incredible tradition and variety all over the world, actually, which I feel is disappearing fast these days. So that's something which I try always to do besides my commissioned work, like whenever I come to places, to look also at a different part of architecture. Hello.
Thanks. Thanks, Ivan. If Eva could solve her problem, she came back with us. And yes. I would like to give her the floor because she of course, wants to continue the interview with you.
Great.
Disappearing fast these days. So
Eva,
that's something I always to do besides my commission work.
Eva, if you can slow a bit the volume of your computer because it's very high.
Thanks. Thanks, Eva. If Eva could solve her problem, so she came back to us.
And maybe if you can follow the interview here in the conversation more on YouTube. It's okay?
Hi, it's nice to hear you, but I have such a big problem, a technical problem, that I must say that it was, that I was not listening very carefully, just fighting with Zoom. So maybe you can remind me where we are now.
Yes, yes, I remind you, Eva, no problem. I try to do your...
Thank you so much.
And we arrived at the question about the favorite picture of that I didn't put to Ivan yet. So quite at the end of the first question that we prepared. So if I want, I launch this so you can join and then you continue. One question from Eva was about which is Ivan, your favorite picture. I mean, not the most famous or not maybe the most published, but the picture that he, for you has a symbolic meaning.
That's such a difficult question, actually. you know, like. That's often sort of the things which are fresh on your mind, the last kind of last travels, the last things you encountered in a way. But at the moment, like this whole lockdown, like I'm also forced to stay here in Amsterdam at the moment. So I'm working on my archive a lot and sort of looking also very carefully, like usually all the commissioned work and all the urgent work are things which are perfectly cataloged and traceable in my archive. But then there's a lot of other things you try to document over the years, which kind of tend to disappear into a large archive. So it's something I'm working on at the moment very much. And you find always really interesting things then back when you haven't looked for a long time. So what I was just telling also before, like the vernacular and these other sort of places which you encounter during the travels, and I'm trying to focus a bit on that in my archive, and there's a lot of things which appear, but I can't tell you what is the favorite one, but they're around that subject in a way.
But what, which one photo is for you most symbolic?
Now, like in a way, I think for what was really interesting to see what touched also so many people and still is doing that after now 7-8 years almost, is that image of New York after Sandy, of course. Like it was, for me, it was such a natural thing to do. Like I was there, I was stuck in New York. I thought, let's photograph the city from above because I always fly over New York. And this is such a unique moment to show it in the dark and the light. At the moment when I photographed it, like, yeah, it was special, but I had no idea that it could reach such an audience and transform, like make so many people look in such a different light, literally, to the city and this whole, strange moment where the city was in, and to show how the center of the world, so to say, can be at the same time so fragile lost in a way. And that image that seems to still, that still makes the rounds all over the world whenever there are these sort of events and gets referenced to. And that was really interesting to see. And that, of course, was a very specific moment in time, and that no one else also had the idea to go up, and that you're the only one sort of to, even in a city with millions of people, to capture that perspective. That was interesting to see, yeah.
Thank you so much. We are waiting for questions from the audience, but I still do not see it. One moment. But I also, if we have to wait 5 minutes, I think that it can be also very interesting to us. I read in one of your interviews that your house in Amsterdam burned down a few years ago. I was astonished by your statement that this said event freed you, as you understood that you did not need anything. The pandemic we are having now is also a catastrophe and limitation. Does the pandemic situation overwhelm you? Do you see something positive in it for the future?
Yeah, it's a kind of a complete opposite moment in a way as where I was after that moment that my house burned down. It was in 2011. At that time, I had my place, my studio, and my apartment here in Amsterdam, which completely burned down. And I was already for years traveling so much that there was very little there. And it felt actually a bit as a liberation at that moment to not have that physical location anymore. And I really didn't really need it anymore. I wasn't there when it happened. So everything I needed, I had always in my suitcase in a way. So I just continued with what I was doing. But at the moment, my life is quite the opposite in a way. At the moment, I have a family, 2 kids, and we take them also everywhere around the world. And nowadays, we have actually 2 places. One here is Amsterdam, and one is just above New York, where the kids grow up in either one of these places. But now, we're also really forced to stay here. And this, what I was saying earlier in the conversation also, it's the first time, I think, in 20 years that I've been forced to sit in one place for such a long time. It's interesting. It gives, of course, a very different dynamic. And I'm at the moment much more involved with the family things here than the commissioned work or my other work. But it also forces me to look more careful at my all the work I've been creating over the last 2 decades almost. And I think the way things develop, it's we can recognize the sort of incredible moment in time we lived in the last 2 decades, where traveling was so incredibly easy. That's something I think which we won't return to in a long time, that definitely gives a lot of food for thought and in a way also thinking of how we should prioritize a lot of things in the future.
So now we have a lot of questions from the audience.
Yes.
And it's try to talk about very interesting subjects. So the first question to you is, what equipment do you use to take photos? Very technical, but I think it's interesting for a lot of architects.
Sure. Yeah, no, for me, it's relatively simple off-the-shelf equipment. I work mainly with handheld. It's, yeah, to go into the technical side, it's Canon cameras. You work with the sort of top of the line, but here, relatively small handheld cameras, which you can, like, I work usually alone by myself. I carry everything around by myself. You try to be a kind of fly on the wall in places and not to be too visible or as a photographer there. So for me, it's important to have everything as compact as possible, basically. And in a way, I can't wait till the moment that I can do everything with my phone in a way. And like what I usually post, for instance, on Instagram, that's already all taken with my phone. But I think there comes a moment when, yeah, this miniaturization of cameras and so becomes more and more. And I try to be on the forefront of that.
In front of your lens, what is the most important and determined element, the context or the aesthetic of the place?
Sorry, the first part I didn't hear well. Can you repeat it one more time?
Yes. What is most important and determined element, the context where you are, or the aesthetic of the place?
I would probably say the context, like in a way, like I try to use the architecture really as a sort of background in documenting everyday life, what people do in a place and what makes a place unique and what makes a place, how people make a place unique in a way. And I think architecture, it's something like, we're surrounded by it all the time. And that's also a way how I try to depict the places and describe the places.
Mm-hmm. Duccio Malagamba mentioned earlier that he conceives his work as an architectural critic using images rather than words. Ivan, do you approach the subjects you photograph from a similar critical angle?
I work completely independent, and what I said earlier, also the way I work, like it's not that you get like a perfect brief, or like I try to stay also as far away as possible from the sort of totally beautified shots and like almost advertising photography of architecture that which sort of amplifies just the building. Like it's much more, you try to tell a story on the place and the relevance of that architecture in that place. So in a way, like you can try also, you can be critical also of a place. Like I don't have to like it always to photograph a place. You often show also the oddities, the juxtapositions of like the strangeness of how it might not fit in a place. Like I think all this, when you start to ask yourself all these questions, you can create an interesting document, which is also interesting for an audience outside the architecture field.
And it's a question connected with Instagram. So is the era of Instagram, so architecture is very important in the moment. Don't you have the impression that the perception of architecture has changed because of Instagram?
I can't really answer that. I don't know. But what I do know, like that Instagram is, of course, an amazing way, like a direct way to publish images and for everyone. And that's sort of the thing nowadays also, like everyone walks around with a camera. And I always say, like, the best camera is the camera you have with you. So you can capture moments and places which you before were hard to capture, or like you didn't have the camera with you, or you didn't have the means to document a place. And I think that's the big liberation of this moment in time, that everyone is taking pictures. And you, like, also when you're not in a place, like, it's an incredible way to explore a place because there's now such an excess of images everywhere.
So maybe it is a kind of archive of our life, this kind of Instagram videos and photos. But there is also one question connected with technical aspects. Is working with photography and with video the same in terms of how you approach the topic to explain?
Sorry, I didn't catch it completely. Is working with photography and?
So the question is working with video the same as making photos? Or do you feel there are some differences?
I'm very sorry, it's breaking up a little bit. I cannot hear it very well. Can you repeat it one more time?
Okay. Is working with video and with photographs the same, or you see the differences?
Videos, yeah, okay. It's a different approach, I think. Like, of course, nowadays with in technical ways, like, it's very similar. You can do video and still images with within the same camera and with almost the same equipment, so it becomes very close. But I have the frustration, I like to do videos as well, but I try kind of at the same time stay away from it, because I feel my own frustration when I try to do both. Like, that it's a very different approach. Like, with photos, you work towards like a sort of defining moment to capture where something which is happening in the image, the place, the light, and all these kind of things come together. Whereas with video, it's of course much more a longer story you try to tell. And when I try to do both at the same time, it's totally frustrating, because you think always, oh, that moment I should have caught on video, or that moment I should have caught on a still. So I just made the choice to stay with stills.
Okay, and to connect with the workshop of this morning, do you think copyright issues are clear between architects, photographers, and owners of the building?
That is sometimes still a little bit a question, and it's of course also different countries and different places have different copyright regulations, and especially like in that sense, France, where the copyright of an architect and the building is much more protected, and where you have to describe that more clearly. But and then there's of course the sometimes the total ignorance of clients of copyrights and what they can do with images. It's a sort of a constant thing which is always in motion, and where you have sometimes to like educate your clients a little bit about, and there's sometimes outright strange questions or issues arising out of copyright. Like, I can give one example. It was a purely a small project which I photographed years and years ago, and it was a strange, a little detail, a glass detail of a building, it's been a couple of years ago, I have to remember exactly what happened. There was a glass manufacturer who wanted to use that image, and they thought, like, oh, it's it's too expensive, let's re-photograph it. And they made an exact copy. Like, they looked very careful at my image and made an exact copy of that image, re-photographing the exactly the same place, waiting for the same light and so on. And then I discovered that in an advertisement. And there you get interesting issues, of course, and with lawyers and different views of like what is the real image and how do you protect that? But yeah, so there's always interesting things happening in that sense.
Mm-hmm. So one more question connected with architects. So have you ever had to deal with any architect who he disagreed with your approach to his, her work? And somebody asked, if so, how do you explain your work to the architect? If you want to explain, of course.
there are definitely sometimes like, or like I think maybe that was more in the beginning, especially like when architects were not so familiar yet with my work and also were working more with the traditional sort of very clean architectural photographs, kind of with the disappearing surroundings and the context. And where I try to show also as much of the context and the everyday city and the roughness of a place and all these kind of things, I try to incorporate all these things also in it. And there were definitely issues sometimes with architects where they try to push you either to crop the images and so on, or edit images out or parts out of the image. I always refuse that, but then at the same time, like, you photograph a lot around the place, and when it's commissioned for an architect makes also often a kind of different selection of the final images, which sort of tell the story in their opinion versus my opinion, and then it's still what you photograph and what will become a final series of images, which goes to the architecture press, which is of course more focused on the building. But in that sense, for me, it's always interesting to work also on my books and other ways to bring the work out where, which is not the commission immediately, the commissioned work, and where I can show also sort of the other side, literally, of a building or a place, and where I'm completely free.
Yes, I absolutely understand, because I have the same problem in architectural magazine, because I think it is often the situation that architects want to choose photos because they thought that it will be better for their image.
Yeah.
So I think that we have to go to the end, but I have also one more question. Is there any question I didn't ask and that you don't find between questions from the audience that you want to hear? In other words, Ivan, please feel free to propose a question or to dedicate us some thoughts.
What I was trying to describe also earlier, like, it's so important also to look at the sort of larger body of work, which always sort of tends to disappear a little bit in the busyness of everyday life and the commissions and so. So for me, it's an interesting moment now to really sit still here and go through that whole archive, and that comes back to the previous question also, to show kind of the other gaze around the sites and the places which I've been traveling to over the last 20 years, and to show that part of my archive, hopefully in a kind of different context at some point.
Thank you, Ivan. So I regret to say that now is the moment, like in Nelly Furtado's song, why do all good things come to the end? So I take the liberty to shortly sum it up. A beautiful photo seduces, but an interesting photo opens the door to human's soul. Some people are drawn by photos of nature, others by photos of people. Some photos are scaly symbols of era, the photo of the naked napalm girl in Vietnam, or three-year-old Syrian refugee who drowned while escaping. Displaced photos cannot be deleted from our common memory. But photos of architecture, who cares? Photographs of architecture are fundamental for architectural magazine. Whom else can they really interest? And here we meet Ivan Ban. The power of Ivan Ban's photographs lies in the fact that they show a broad context, bring up delicate relations with surroundings, familiarize with difficult spaces and their weight aesthetics, and above all, show architecture in the context of real life, as the Torre de David in Caracas, Venezuela. It is for such photos that we love Ivan Ban. Thank you, Ivan, and we keep waiting for more.
Thank you so much for the invitation to be here. It was very nice to be in conversation.
And I thank also all participants for your attention. Thank you.
So, thank you, Eva. Thank you, Ivan. Thank you, Miriam, as well, for supporting the technical problems with Eva.
We are
at the end of the second edition of the European Conference on Architecture in the Media. It was conceived, and it has truly been, a place to meet and exchange experiences on the dissemination of architecture. A meeting place for journalists, cultural institutions, photographers, communication professionals, architects, and architecture lovers. Architecture and the Media is focused on architecture perceived as culture and aims to support the dissemination of both core values and most cutting-edge topics through the media, either news and specialized media, print, broadcast, and online. Architecture and the Media has been organized by Fundación Mies van der Rohe and LABO with the support of Creative Europe and the Barcelona City Council as part of the dissemination program of the European Union Prize for Contemporary Architecture, Mies van der Rohe Award. It has taken place during the Barcelona Architecture Week, that this year held an online edition from 7 to 17th May with more than 150 proposals. This year's edition has been curated by Miriam Giordano, expert in communication, director of LABO, and longtime partner of Fundación Mies van der Rohe. Thank you once more, Miriam, for all the effort to you and your team. These are some of the questions that we have tried to answer, and maybe we have achieved. It's all about what makes architecture alluring for the media. Why is it such a challenge for architecture to gain visibility in the cultural section of news media? What presence does it have in other sections, such as politics and economy? How significant is the role of the media in making architecture understood and appreciated by broader audiences? What makes a case of success in the collaboration between institutions and the media in the common goal of the diffusion of architecture? More than 2,500 people have viewed until this very moment the videos of the lectures, talks, roundtables, workshops that we have been running for 4 days. In this second edition of Architecture and the Media, together with general topics, we have focused on television, radio, and audiovisual media, and we have deepened the cross-cutting subject of architectural images, especially today with Ivan Ban. These were topics that arose in the debates 2 years ago. That's why we have focused on them in this edition. New themes have arisen these days. So those are the themes that we will discuss probably in 2 years' time. In these times, we are experiencing an extraordinary situation that limits travels and the possibility of holding events together. But we still wanted to keep alive the debate on dissemination of architecture. For this reason, this year the venue of the event moved from the inspiring Barcelona Mies van der Rohe Pavilion, where I am, luckily for me, to the YouTube channel of Fundación Mies van der Rohe. It was challenging, but we're happy that we tried. Maybe the third edition will be a combination of both. If you can come, you will be more than welcome. If not, you will be able to follow it online wherever you are. Finally, I want to thank deeply our guests that agreed to share with us their knowledge and opinions. I am really amazed after listening to all of them. Writers, architects, editors, lawyers, photographers, radio speakers, TV reporters. If you have missed any of the talks, please do not hesitate to look for it in our webpage. They're all extremely good. Thank you for coming. I hope to see you soon here at the Barcelona Pavilion. Thank you all.